We are going to use Gauss-Jordan method with pivoting to find the inverse of this matrix. Gauss-Jordan method with or without pivoting starts the same, meaning we copy the matrix A and attach to it an identity matrix, creating an augmented matrix in that fashion. Now, if we were using classical Gauss-Jordan method, our pivots would be on the diagonal and we would be starting with a zero, which of course cannot be a pivot, so the first step would be interchange the first row with the second row. In the Gauss-Jordan method with pivoting, the choice of pivots is arbitrary, so you don't have to interchange rows to force them to be on the diagonal. So here in our first step, we can choose any entry, the matrix on the left of course, to be our pivot. We can just choose this 2 and eliminate every other entry in that column. This is called pivot column. Now above it you have a 0, so no operation needed. Below it we have a 2, so we simply subtract from row 3 row 2 and we will have a 0 right there. So the first row unchanged, the second row unchanged, and the third one created by subtracting the second. So 2 minus 2 is 0, minus 3 plus 5, 1 minus 1, 0 minus 0, 0 minus 1, and 1 minus 0, which is 1. Okay. Now, in the next step, we're choosing another pivot. The choice is arbitrary. However, you have to be a bit careful because there is a beautiful 1 standing here. So you could think to yourself, well, that's an easy operation. I'm going to just use this 1 to eliminate everything else in that potential pivot column, which means remove that negative 1. But in that same step, while removing this negative 1, you would be subtracting row 1 minus row 2. What you would do is you would create a non-zero entry right here, which means you would destroy the first pivot column that was just created. So to avoid this, destroying your previous work, what you want to do is in the next step, before you choose the next pivot, you want to cover the row in which you already have your previous pivots. So in this case, we're going to cover the second row because that's where our first pivot was, in the second row. And we're going to choose our next pivot from the remaining visible entries, which will be 4, negative 1, 2, or 0. 0, of course, cannot be a pivot entry. So we're going to choose this negative 1. The hint here is use 1s or negative 1s because they're easy to operate on. And now there is just 1 element in this column, in this pivot column, to zero out, which is this 1. And simple operation R2 plus R1 will make a 0 where we want it. The first row remains unchanged. The second row changes by addition. And the third row remains unchanged. Okay. Now we cover the first row where we have our pivot, the second row where we have our pivot. So really there is no other option left. We have only 1 entry, 1 possible pivot, the 2 here. Now whether you want to change it into a 1 first and then zero out the column, or you want to use this element, this 2, to zero out the column and then change it into 1, it's totally your choice. I'm just going to leave it as a 2. And use row operations to eliminate the negative 1 and the 4 above it. So this will require 2 operations, R1 minus 2R2, because 4 minus 2R2 times 2 is going to give me 0, and R2, which is a negative 1, I have to add a half of R3, which is a half of a 2. And so we go. The third row is unchanged, so I'm going to start with copying it. And then R1 minus 2 R3. So we have 0 minus 0, 4 minus 4, minus 1 minus 0, 1 minus 0, Now 0 minus 2 times minus 1, which is 2, and 0 minus 2 times 1, which is minus 2. And now r2 plus a half r3. So 2 plus 0 minus 1 plus 1, 0. Here is 0. This is unchanged. Now we have 1 minus a half and 0 plus a half. Okay, and now we have three pivot columns, three rows. Now the elimination process is ended, so what's left is some cosmetic work to do. We have to change all the pivots into ones. So first row by negative 1, second divided by 2, third divided by 2. Here we go. And the very last step is to just switch rows around, interchange them so as to have proper identity matrix on the left, which means first row has to go all the way down, and then second and third have to be shifted by one position. So R1 moves into R2, and then R2 moves into R3, and that will take care of it. This is really, these are two operations that really don't have to be described, to be honest, but there they are. And now whatever we have on the right is our inverse matrix that we were searching for. So we're copying it separately. And this is our inverse.